Dear Valve, you know what's dangerous? Mixing a local IPA, a 12-year-old Glenlivet, and general relativity. You thought I was out of control before? Wait until I conduct space-time science while drunk, bitch! It may seem irresponsible to mix Einstein, Hawking, Planck, and Dirac with fermented hops and distilled wheat, but holy hell, you know what, Valve? Your game brought me to this point. A carefully measured and delivered application of mind-altering substances is the only way I can make sense of your portal guns. But thankfully, through a clever ingestion of ethanol and science, I have finally unraveled the obfuscent truths behind your portal guns. And the truth is God. Damn! Wait, what? I'm not constantly yelling, am I? Alright, fine. I solemnly swear for this entire video I won't shout, except for that beginning part. I'm cutting myself off, cold turkey. Anyway, back to the thing. Portal. People have been asking me to do the physics behind Portal for like ages. It was one of the first requests I got, and it's one of the topics I've been the most loath to do other than Tracer from Overwatch because the science is freaking complicated, headache-inducing, and is bound to bring armchair scientists out of the woodwork to hurl their aggressive actuallys at me with reckless abandon. But I'm here and I'm ready to do this because the consequences of Portal may be utterly earth-shatteringly frightening, but the science behind it is exciting, complex, and one of the coolest things you can take back and repeat to your high school physics teacher to reveal how much they were paying attention in class in college. So, enough dawdling, and let's get this frickin' thing started. For the five of you who don't know, Portal was the breakaway success that Valve tossed into the orange box as an afterthought to fill out their bundle. Built by developers from DigiPen, who first made the game Narbacular Drop, Portal is a puzzle game where you navigate test rooms and avoid obstacles by making Einstein your bitch. And by that, I mean you make portals, which connect to each other so you can instantaneously move from one place to another. There are a few interesting applications of this mechanic, for instance, putting a portal at the bottom of a pit and jumping into it in order to leap great chasms, or for those of you who are more perpetual motion machine inclined and have no fear of infinite heights, you can place one right over the other and fall into it, reaching terminal velocity and somehow not dying when you hit the ground because of these things that I definitely don't have the time to get into right now. And it's as simple as that. Get from door to door using the powers of this magnificent gun and take your check to the bank and cash it because damn, this game is amazing. But these portals, these instantaneous gateways from point A to point B are completely absurd, right? The answer may surprise you. There's basically only one way, according to the laws of the universe as we understand them, that these portals could possibly work. Wormholes. Wormholes are, you know what, let's just back up for a second, because the first thing wormholes are is a f***ing headache. And of course, like most of my topics lately, we gotta start with Einstein. But I'll be brief because I talk about this guy a lot. Einstein revolutionized the way we think about gravity, but more importantly, space. In order to figure out how it is that light moves at the same speed to all observers, he came up with two theories about how the universe is structured that prevail to this day: general relativity and special relativity. Before this, we had classical physics. You know, Isaac Newton, apples falling from trees, etc. The problem is that these rules for gravity, forces, and velocity don't really hold up on cosmic scales and are terrible at explaining how massless particles like photons behave. Plus, you start getting into problems with speed. Like, if you're in a train moving at 60 meters per second and you throw a ball at 5 meters per second, relative to you, the ball is moving at 5 meters per second. Relative to some dude standing outside of the train, it's moving at 65 meters per second. There's no such thing, really, as an objective speed or frame of reference. This is one of the problems that Einstein fixes. There's no longer any objective measuring points. Instead, what you have is inertial frames of reference in a curved, three-dimensional space called space-time because space and time are inextricably linked. Mass causes exaggerated curves in space-time, and acceleration also causes exaggerated curves in space-time. In order to explain this new concept and prove it works, Einstein developed his famous field equations. Here it is, right here. Look at it. You think it's one of those simple equations where you just plug in your variables and hit enter? Hell no. Just one parameter of this damn thing could take a well-studied mathematician the better part of an afternoon to solve. They're non-linear, a pain in the ass, and have like 1,000 different portions that need double-checked. Still, they describe almost every large behavior observable in the universe, and smart as hell people have used them to discover amazing things before they were ever directly observed, like black holes, which are a solution to the field equations discovered by Karl Schwarzschild while he was, get this, busy fighting in the trenches in World War I. I guess there wasn't really a lot for a warrior mathematician to do in his free time while waiting to die. Which Schwarzschild did shortly after. Damn you, universe, you're stealing all the great minds of our world! Black holes, while seemingly fantastic, are pretty much 100% real. Even though we've never directly observed them, we've seen their effects. So we're pretty certain they're real. But then, there's wormholes. Wormholes are another solution to the field equations, and are frankly, kinda ridiculous. Unlike black holes, we're far, far from certain that they actually exist. And before you share that one article and say,
"But Austin, they created one in a lab,"
take a seat, son. Projecting magnetic fields is not the same thing as a full-blown space-time wormhole. Also called an Einstein-Rosen bridge, these things were also an early solution found in the field equations. Basically, here's how they work. Take two places in space-time that are, one light year apart. In order to fly there, you have your magical super space drive thingy that allows you to violate the laws of physics and fly at the speed of light in a straight line. It would take you a year to get there in this way. However, if you could somehow fold your point A and point B together and then pull them apart, you could effectively change the distance between point A and point B. Now, what you're actually doing is more or less changing the definition of what a meter is, but one step through a wormhole actually allows you to travel further than a step would in real life. Do you have a headache yet? Me too. So let's look at portals. When you create a portal on two walls, what you're effectively doing is compressing space-time so that the two walls at that point are stuck back-to-back, while all of the routes still require you to walk a normal distance like some sort of physics-respecting plebeian. It's unknown exactly how a wormhole would actually form if they were real, but the prevailing theory is that first a black hole is created, and then magically spread apart so it no longer has a point of singularity. There are, however, a few problems with wormholes. The biggest is that in order to stay even remotely stable, they have to be super small. I'm talking subatomic small, like Planck scale small. One Planck is 1.616229 times 10 to the negative 35th meters. Super tiny. But this isn't even the biggest problem. Nope, let's just say that you could actually make a wormhole the size of a portal door. No problem, you got it. According to the laws of the universe that we hold extraordinarily dear, all wormholes, big, small, and in between, are doomed to collapse, like instantly, before you'd even know they were there. Why is that? Because they require negative mass to retain their shape. You see, wormholes don't want to exist because they're cosmologically nihilistic and hate that they violate everything you love and hold dear. The instant they snap into being, they want to snap back shut because of the tumultuous gravitational forces and space-time tidal effects that exist inside them. In order to keep this from happening, you need negative mass to balance out the implosive pressure. That's right, you heard me. Negative mass. Not to be confused with negative matter, which has a positive mass. No, we're talking about a whole new stratum of weird. Negative particles. And in accordance with the, you know what? Okay, just give me a second. Okay, so, you thought wormholes were confusing enough trying to mentally picture something being closer without it actually being closer? Yeah. It gets worse. So let's say you have a wormhole, right? And inside the tunnel of this wormhole, there's matter. Not a ton, but some. But you know that you need negative mass, so you take all of it out. Every particle, every molecule, everything. There is nothing there. In order to keep the wormhole from collapsing, you have to take more matter out than is actually there. But you can't, right? Nothing can come from nothing. The laws of conservation of energy and Billy Preston told me so.
Nothing from nothing leaves nothing.
But while you might think this is true, you're wrong. Dead wrong. And in order to understand why, we're gonna have to leave Einstein behind and shift gears from general relativity into quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics is the study of the smallest stuff in the universe and how they behave during the smallest time periods imaginable. And during these short time periods, everything you think you know about how the universe works goes out the freaking window. This incredibly amazing sentence in Scientific American summed it up perfectly. Quantum mechanics allows and indeed requires temporary violations of conservation of energy. You see, if you look at a small region of space that's filled with absolutely nothing, and I mean nothing at all, with the most super-powered, ultra-mega Superman microscope and slowed down time a hell of a lot, you'd witness something positively amazing. Instantaneously, all over the universe, at any point, particles pop into existence. For no reason, just blam, there's a photon. But at that exact same moment, a negative photon is also created, which has the exact negative properties to the positive photon. Then, almost as quickly as they're created, they pop back together out of existence. Boom, done. The Casimir experiment was created to prove this is real, and boy, did it. Basically, if you take two thin plates, right, and you place them really close together, in between the plates, you can actually limit the type of particles that can snap into existence. Smaller ones, mostly. Outside the plate, however, there are no such restrictions to what particles can spontaneously pop into and out of being. So, because of this, there should be a slightly higher pressure on the outside of the plates as there is on the inside because of the higher energy particles. And there is. So, how the hell does this work with the conservation of energy? Actually, it doesn't strictly violate this idea, because the universe has a limited amount of stuff. Like, for the sake of simplicity, the universe has 10 stuffs. If you want to make something that's one stuffs big, you have to balance that out against the ledger of the 10 stuffs. You gotta take that one stuffs from something. Now, with these negative particles and positive particles, the laws of the universe aren't being violated because they actually cancel out in the ledger. There's still a net of zero. We'll talk about this more if we ever tackle Hawking radiation, but for now, just accept that this is real. So, in order to have a functioning portal, you gotta stuff it with negative mass to keep it open. So, we've just established that negative mass does in fact exist, so awesome! So just stuff that portal with it, baby, yeah! Oh, just hold your horses there, Hasselhoff. We're not nearly done yet. First of all, creating negative mass in a controlled way? Super hard. But let's say you can do it. The problem becomes twofold. One, the more mass you need to borrow, the less time it sticks around. Those little photons disappear nearly instantly as they recombine. And the more negative mass you have to borrow against the bank of the universe, the quicker the bank of the universe wants that matter back. This is a problem because wormholes? Wormholes require a metric ton of negative mass to stay open. How much is a metric ton? Well, it varies from wormhole to wormhole, but with one the size of our portal that stays open for as long as it does, we can use the Morris-Thorne metric to calculate roughly how much negative mass this pretty modest wormhole would require. I mean, it's about the size of a door, and at most only stretches about a football field's distance away. So, how much negative mass would this thing need? Only 70 sextillion kilograms! That's fine! I'm fine! I'm not yelling here! We're good! Just so you know, that's enough negative mass to cancel out the entire existence of the moon in an instant. That's how freaking unstable these things are. And as we just shown, in order to create negative mass, you have to create positive mass. You have to, absolutely have to balance the universal checkbook. Which means, every time you create one of these portals, you're essentially exploding a moon's worth of mass into existence to compensate. That can't be healthy for you. But wait, there's more! Show them what's behind door number two! You're bending space-time. Congratulations! But somehow, maybe, you found a way to do it without creating a moon-sized explosion. But you know what you haven't done? Found a way to do it without actually compressing space-time. That means a ton of that mass at the very edges of the portal is being folded together with less space between them than a sheet of paper. Those walls and everything in between them are being smushed together. Smashing atoms this close together literally smashes atoms together, creating fusion reactions which creates heat and radiation and unstoppable damage to the matter around you. Even if you could find a way to avoid the horrific negative mass implications of these portals, you're doomed to either A, get your face melted off immediately by a hydrogen bomb level explosion, explosion caused by the instantaneous collapse of local space-time, or die a horrific death from radiation poisoning. And I know I'm yelling now, I'm sorry, Kangler, I just can't help myself! The cake may be a lie, and you may escape the grasp of GLaDOS, but there's no way, no possible way you could just use this portal gun at all and not have, like, just the worst day ever. And I'm sorry to say it, Valve, but your portals wouldn't work at all in real life. And that's aside from the whole infinite falling thing you can do by placing two portals beneath one another. But I still love you. But I'm coming for my cake. Sincerely, Austin. Thank you everyone for watching my video on the portals, which was a pain in the butt. I spent like 5 days trying to solve Einstein field equations, which is why I know how hard they are to solve, because they're freaking difficult to solve. And I tried to get an actual space relativity scientist to come in and help me, but they're busy doing actual important stuff, so they didn't help me. But anyway, thank you for watching. Follow me at AR Horrigan on Twitter. Subscribe to this freaking channel if you haven't yet, because you absolutely have to, and because I said so. And I'll use science to kill you. No, I just won't. I won't do that. I love you. Anyway, watch some more of my videos. Watch some other people's videos. I'm gonna go parent my child, I guess.